as I was talking about the types of descent, it's also important to try to understand the descents beside trying to help us the line of ancestry, inheritance and property transmission from one person to the other. A very important aspect of descent is that it determines the pattern of residence or locality. So, we see it's a unilineal descent where there is a patrilineal descent. We see the form of residence is patrilocal or virilocal. That is, the couple after marriage, the women moves to stay with the husband or husband's father's group. So, it is patrilocal, which is father's group, virilocal, which is husband group. In a similar pattern, in a matrilineal society, there are three forms of residence. One is matrilocal, that is the residence with the mother's group. The second is exorilocal residence, which is residence with wife's group. And the third form is avanculocal residence. Avanculocal residence is residence with mother's brother. So, all the three are kind of related with matrilineal descent. Then similarly, in the terms of cognatic descent, we have uterolocal, in which it could be either the patrilocal or it could be matrilocal. And in the case of ambilineal, we have ambilocal residence. So, if we look into the diagram of the patrilineal and matrilineal descent and going back to the first few slides, we see that there is a kind of a representation or diagrammatic representation of patrilineal and matrilineal descent. And if we look into the diagram on the left side, we see the triangles are connected with a single red line, and then the last triangle and the circle is connected through a blue line. So, these are kind of a relation which is being very clearly shown in the diagram: the ego, the father's father, and then we have ego's sister and ego's mother. So, the line of descent is through the male. And the last triangle tells us an arrow pointed downwards that tells us about the continuity of the lineage that it will go on further. Similarly, coming to the diagram on the right, we see that circles are connected through a straight line, and then there are two lines. One is upward, which shows a relation between mother and father, and a downward blue line, which tells us about the relation between the ego, and which here we could be the circle and her brother. So, the line of descent is through the female. Now, when we look into the types of unilineal descent, we have lot of concepts which are kind of quite confusing, and therefore it's important to have a clarity in terms of it. And it's also in terms of trying to understand the distinction between these. So, we have very similar concept like descent. We also have a concept called lineage. Lineage refers to the line through descent is traced. This is done either through father's line or mother's line. When we go through anthropological literature, we see lineage and descent are more or less kind of used synonymously. But for a purpose of clarification, it can be said that descent is a smaller group than the lineage. So, and that means that lineage can be up to the third generation or fourth generation, whereas descent is your immediate generation or the second generation. And a larger group than the lineage is a clan. So, UDG, that is unilineal descent group comprising more than 10 generations, consisting of members who claim a common ancestry, even though cannot trace step by step the exact connection to a common ancestor. So, here we see the difference between lineage and clan. A clan, as I said, is a larger group in which the ancestor is not known. And secondly, we cannot clearly, diagrammatically or genealogically refer to the exact relation between the ego and the members of the clan. When then a group larger than the clan is a phatri. So, when we a kind of a combination, or when two or more clan come together, it could kind of form a phatri. And when two or three more phatris join together, that is the largest group, it is the kind of known as moieties. And if we go the other way round, we say that in a society is divided into two groups. Each group is known as moieties. When there is a subdivision of moiety, phatris are formed. When there is a subdivision of phatri, a clan will be formed. And a subdivision of the clan, the lineage will be formed. A further subdivision of lineage or descent would be formed. And the most small unit, which is the focal of discussion, is the alimentary family, which is considered as the nucleus of kinship chart. So, if we represent in the diagram, we see the outer circle is the moiety, then the second circle is the phatri, then we have clan, lineage and descent. So, this is a kind of a diagrammatic representation of these groups of kinship chart. Now, when we look into the features of UDG, there was a study by Mayer Fortes who has studied the main features of UDG, and according to him, it is a dural concept. Why is it considered as a dural concept? It is considered as a dural concept because it is kind of legitimizing the inheritance of property. The ownership of property is through the line of descent. It gives you access to membership of a group. So, descent determines your membership. So, it's a patrilineal group. You will be on birth given a membership into your father's group. A lineage is a corporate group from outside, that is its relation to other defined groups and association. Here the term concept of corporate group is being taken in from the term corporation, and also the sense in which it was used by Max Weber in the sense that it talks about the unity of the group. So, the three criteria which will help us to understand the corporate group is it has a common residence, it has an common property holding group, and third is it is united through rituals and festivals. The entire group kind of get together. So, a lineage can be a corporate group if they are residing together, they all have stake in the same common property, and since they are residing together, are co-owners of property, they would take part in religious activity as well. It is might be described as a single legal personality, one person, as the Asanti puts it. This he is talking in terms of the relation between one group lineage versus the other. So, in a kind of a conflicting relation, lineage A is a unity in kind of contrast to lineage B. But that does not mean that there is no differences or there is no kind of everybody is kind of one. It's only saying that it is a unity from outside. So it only stands true when there is a conflict, and the settlement of conflict needs to be taken care. The most important feature of UDG is the corporate organization. So, lineage is most developed in a segmentary society. Now, this concept of segmentary society has been given by Evans Pritchard in his study of newer society. According to Evans Pritchard, each lineage segments from the main lineage to form a smaller group. But each segment is still part of the larger whole. It is not separate from it, kind of independent of it. It is just separated in terms of residence. In such society, lineage is not only a corporate group in the strict legal sense, but also the primary political association. So, here it is talking about societies which did not have the formation of nation state or any political institution. In this case, the kinship was being used as a criteria for regulating the political and economic life. And if we go into the study of Evans Pritchard, he shows in his study how each segment or kind of each lineage was divided into maximal, minimal, major and minor lineage, and each of it had its own role in the regulation of the political affairs of the society. Evans Pritchard's study tells us that there can be an order even if we do not have a political institution like the state or government and legislative body, and therefore he calls it as an ordered anarchy. When we try to understand the next feature of UDG is that lineage exists in perpetuity. In perpetuity means it has no start and no end. So, it implies that the composition of the group will change. The composition of the group changes due to birth and death of members, and also due by other process like marriage and adoption. But then it will never come that every member of has kind of ended, and therefore it is something which exists prior to our birth and would continue irrespective of individual's death. The other important term which helps us to understand segmentary lineage society is fission and fusion, again used in the study of Evans Pritchard. Fission, as the term says, that there is a kind of a breakup. So, the two lineage kind of separates from the original lineage and sets up its own unit. And similarly, when there is fusion, so fusion means coming together of two lineage to form a larger clan. So, these fission and fusion would take place in the newer society depending on the environment and the demand for political order in the society. So, if we go into the concept of lineage segmentation, it is a model of social organization based on branching system of kinship descent, first described by Evans Pritchard in his classificatory study of the newer. The newer is a text written by Evans Pritchard. It is based on the study of a tribal groups in Africa. Where there is a substantial depth in lineage, larger units are subdivided into smaller components through a process of branching or segmentation. It leads to successive formation of smaller groups from parent lineage. Then when we try to kind of understand the whole idea of descent and the significance of unilineal descent, we try to understand that it also helps us to understand the way in which groups are organized in a geographical space. So, it could be either it is discrete that or dispersed, that is they are all spread out in different geographical area, or they are compact. Compact means they are all occupying in a one kind of a geographical area. If we refer to Yako's study by Daryl Ford, he says that the Petrie clan is a compact group, that is all members of a Petrie clan resides in the same geographical territory, whereas Metrie clan is a discrete or dispersed group, that is they are spread out in the geographical area. So, with this we try to have a good understanding of descent. The next term is kinship terminology, and when we look into kinship terminology, the basic contribution has been done by Ratcliffe Brown. Ratcliffe Brown refers to totality of terms which are used to call and designate relatives. Basically, terminology means what are the terms we use for either to address or to refer to a kin in a network. So, there are two ways of actually using the kinship terminology. One is term of address, what you call someone when talking to them. Example, if we call refer to the father of my mother, I will not say he is my mother's father, but I would refer a more regional term as Nana. Or so similarly, all relationships could be kind of addressed by a term. The second is term of reference. So, many a time we do not know the exact term for that relatives, especially for the collateral. So, we will combine a term that is used for lineal relative to refer to the collateral relative. So, if most of the time if we look into the cousins or the concept of cousins, or we look into the kind of distinction that we have between my mother's sister's children or my father's, there is no exact term used for it. So, when I am talking about the person, I will talk about my mother's sister's child, son or daughter. So, that is kind of referring to a kin relative. So, when we come to types of kinship terminology, there are two types of kinship terminology: descriptive, a few specific terms for relative for first order and second order. Now, Ratcliffe Brown in his work on African family and marriage has given us this concept of first order, second order. So, basically he says the members of an elementary family, that is the mother, father, sister, son and daughter, are the first order. And as we keep adding to those relatives, for instance, father's brother would be second order, and then we add a third, that is father's brother's son, so that becomes the third order, and accordingly we move to third, fourth order. So, here he is saying that the first order and the second order are referred by one specific term, and then after that we will use a compound of the term. So, father's brother's son, mother's sister's son or daughter, so that is kind of descriptive. We can exactly explain the relation of an individual with that person in a descriptive kind of a terminology. In a descriptive terminology, lineal and collateral kin are separated. For example, mother and mother's sister, although of the same generation and sex, are distinguished. So here there is a kind of clear clarity in terms of the relationship, and each term will connote the relationship that an individual has with the kin. So the advantage of descriptive is that it is less ambiguous, distant relatives identified easily. Till the fifth order, we can actually trace the exact step-by-step relation to that individual. The second form of kinship terminology is classificatory. A classificatory kinship terminology, a single term is used for two or more kinds of relatives who are included in a single terminology. So, terms which are used for lineal would also be used for collateral. Classificatory terminology binds two relations. For instance, father's brother and mother's brother, there is no difference, and in many tribal society, a same term is used for father's brother and mother's brother, and in many a time the same term is used for all members of that generation, or that is, father would be the same as father's brother and mother's brother, where there is a kind of a no distinction on gender and lineage distinction. Principle of classification may be applied to wider range of relationship. It enables to establish wide range of kinship. When we look into different kinds of classificatory system, we see there is bifurcate merging. Bifurcate means at one level it will have a different term, but at another level it will merge. So that is why it is termed as bifurcate merging. And the anthropological model, or the kind of reference which is done for bifurcate merging, is the Iroquois tribes. Among the Iroquois, the ego differentiates between father and mother's side. So we have these equations which kind of explain us the relation. Father would be equal to father's brother, would be equal to father's sister. Now here the father's sister becomes like a female father. So the same term would be applied to all three category of relatives. Now when we look into the cousins, they kind of, if we kind of try to understand, there are two types of cousins which we need to understand. One is a parallel cousin, which is actually the same sex siblings' children. That is, my mother's sister's children and my father's brother's children, they are my parallel cousin. When I talk about cross cousin, they are children of opposite sex sibling, that is father's sister and mother's brother's children. So that distinction needs to be done. In many classificatory terminology, the same term is used for cross cousin as well as parallel cousins. So the second type of bifurcate merging is Omaha tribes, again a kind of a patrilineal descent where they use the same kind of principle. The cousins are merged across generation. For the mother's brother's son would be equal to mother's brother, and mother's brother's daughter would be equal to mother. So we have a simple where the principle of unity of generation works, and different generations are clubbed into the same class. The next example is of a crow. A crow is a mirror image of Omaha. So that is, Omaha is a patrilineal group. The crow is a matrilineal group. Ego uses a bifurcate merging pattern but applies a skewing rule to lump relatives within his father's matrilineage. So there are certain principles by which certain category of relatives are grouped together. In this society, the father's sister's son is equal to father, and father's sister's daughter is equal to father's sister. So these are kind of a principle which will help us to understand unity of lineage. This system is generally found in society with strong matrilineal kinship emphasis, and therefore the significance is on the matrilineage. After the terminology, the next concept is family and household. Family refers to group of people living together and functioning as a single household, usually consisting of parent and their children. In kinship studies, there is a distinction made between family and household. The family is basically a kind of a unit in which we say there is a kind of a relation between members on blood or marital relation, whereas household kind of becomes a more residential unit in which we could have relatives which are not necessarily related by blood residing together. when we look into the concept of family, there are several types of family which we come across in anthropological literature. The first is a nuclear family or elementary family. Family consists a nuclear family. Basically, if we go into what kind of an understanding comes in from sociologists like A.M. Shah, there is kind of a joint nuclear. It is actually understood in terms of the composition of the family member. So, if it is a simple family with father, mother, son, daughter, then it is kind considered as a nuclear family. And if we kind of extend, that is, we add a member, who is, for instance, the father's sister, who is unmarried or kind of divorced or single, and his children, then it adds member to the composition and therefore it becomes an extended family. The family as a generally defined corporate group is distinguished from the household as a collection of kin and sometimes non-kin who share a common residence. In relation to household, the next concept is domestic group. A domestic group means a set of people sharing the same living space. Cohabitation and shared residence are two essential features. So, all members need not necessarily be related through blood or marriage, but since they are cohabiting and they are residing in the same locality, they would form a domestic group. It is different from a nuclear family, which refers essentially to the married couple and their children. Domestic group, in addition to one of the more nuclear family, might include people without kinship link. So, it is comes the domestic group as a concept comes very close to household. And the concept of corporate group, which I already explained earlier, the kinship unit often constitutes a corporate group which becomes a legal entity in itself and is assigned collective rights on behalf of its member and the estate. Clan is usually a non-corporate group, whereas lineage is a corporate descent group. I said lineage or descent is corporate because of the residence, common property holding and also taking part in the same lineage. A clan, since it is more larger a unit and it's more dispersed, therefore it constitute a non-corporate group. Lineage as a corporate group functions as a unity for land ownership, political representation and mutual aid and support. We also have kind of degree of kinship, primary kinship, secondary kinship, tertiary kinship. So, primary kinship refers to the direct relationship that we have with our primary kin, that is those who are in the first order of kinship. Secondary means relations coming through the primary kinship relation, and similarly tertiary would be those relations coming through the secondary relationship. For example, wife of a brother-in-law would be related to as a tertiary kin. So, it is also in terms of the significance of these kinship relations as we go move from primary to tertiary, the significance in kind of a formal relation between the individual decreases. First order and second order I have already explained. The incest and incest taboo again is very central, and this is actually moving a concept from biological concept to a cultural understanding. So, till understanding of lineage, descent, blood ties, genealogy are some of the concepts used in the initial theories, which was kind of dominated by the descent approach. And then when once we come in, the Levi-Strauss comes into the feature, where he questions the descent approach in trying to argue that blood ties and genealogy in itself cannot be sufficient for understanding kinship relation. He gives us this concept of incest taboo. And as I already said, I'll repeat here, incest is a system of sexual involvement of two people who are closely related to each other. Members of elementary family are not considered as sexual relation through marriages, and therefore there's a taboo. And if we read Levi-Strauss' Elementary Structures of Kinship, he tells us that incest taboo is at the threshold of nature and culture. The fact that we are close to we are like born as individual gives us this whole idea of not breeding in the group in which we live, and the fact that we are also cultural, so we kind of evolve rules which prevents us from kind of having sexual relations with members of elementary family. And because of incest taboo, we have the marriage rules, which is the first marriage rule is exogamy. It is a rule of marriage in which individual has to marry outside his group. So, ex means outside. So, it implies that we are not going to seek a marriage partner within the elementary family or a group. Forms of exogamy which is practiced is gotra, pinned village exogamy, which we kind of refer to or read in newspaper if members of the same gotra, which could be translated as lineage, marry, they could be a kind of considered as incestuous. Similarly, pinned would be translated to the level of clan or having the same ancestor, and if marriages take place with ancestors, common ancestor, it would again be considered as incestuous, and therefore many society also have village exogamy, that we do not marry in the group village in which one is born. The second rule of marriage is endogamy, marriage between people of the same social category, that is we marry within the group. So, the group may be caste, class, tribe, race, village, religious group, etc. Basically, caste, if we look at the level of sub-jati, which is sub-caste, the marriages are endogamous, that is we there is a preference for looking for marriage partner within the same jati. We also have the rule of monogamy and polygamy. To put it simply, monogamy is the rule of one-to-one partner, that you just have one marital partner. Polygamy, there is multiple. So, you have polyandry and polygyny. So, in one there is multiple husbands, the other there is multiple female. So, when we have these kind of understanding, we can all try to kind of help go on into concepts, more and more concepts, because kinship study is almost a kind of a discipline in itself. But these are some of the concepts. If we are aware of these concepts, it will help us to understand some of the anthropological theories and also to help us understand the society itself in which we are living. Because many a time we read newspaper in terms of gotra marriages and we don't actually realize what it is, or we refer to cross cousin marriages taking place in South India and we are not aware of it. So, it's very relevant in order to be have a clarity of concept, in order to understand the societal functions the way it is taking place. With this, I come to an end to today's lecture. I hope you have been able to get hold of some of the key concepts and terms used in kinship studies. Thank you very much.